Hello, I'm Liam Fahey from Business Station, and welcome to today's webinar on smarter video creation from your smartphone. Now, a little bit about me to begin with. So I work for Business Station and the Digital Solutions Program to help businesses grow. My background is I've owned and ran the largest marketing and production company in Central Queensland for the last 14 years. And I shoot on everything from cinema cameras to massive DSLRs. But the content we're talking about today is the mobile phone. You can create an extraordinary amount of content using these devices. They've definitely come a long way since I first started in industry. And the camera quality is getting close, if not on par, to cinema cameras. The biggest difference between this and a cinema camera has to do with the sensor size. But if you're not shooting video for cinema, it's not going to matter. With all things video, the most important part is always the story. If you have a good quality story, then nothing else matters. And in terms of how we rank the quality of video, story first, followed by audio, followed by visual. You don't have to be an expert with filming to create good content for your social media. And looking at the poll that we have up today, it looks like all of you are looking to create video for your social, and one of you already creates some video, which is great to see. So for those of you that are watching this live and are attending, you can use the chat function, the question and answer function in the bottom of your Zoom controls to ask me questions at any point during the webinar. At the end, I'm going to give you a chance to talk directly to me as a panelist. And for those that are watching this later live, on YouTube, I've got links sent to you. If you do have a question, reach out to me at Business Station. So my email is liam.f@businessstation.com.au. Let's get started. So the first thing I want to do is just show you a couple of different examples in terms of video creation. So I'm going to get my screen shared. The example today that we're going to be using is Parker's Calling Meats. Just make sure I've got the right screen there. Sorry. Optimize for video, yes. Okay, so Parker's Quality Meats, they've given me permission to use their page for the purposes of training. And what do we know? We have a video here. I'm just going to click it and play it for you.
G'day, Mick from Parker's Quality Meats. My pick of the week this week, well, I'm on holiday, so I'm obviously going to have a big steak on the barbecue. This is our pure black, barley-fed Angus beef. Absolutely a treat in the mouth. Absolutely beautiful. Get on down and get yourself some today.
It did not like that playback.
G'day, Mick from Parker's Quality Meats.
There's a couple of things I want to point out straight away. This is shot on a DSLR camera. And one of the main features is right here. This is a mode wireless microphone. It allows us to have very clean, very clear audio. I'm going to go into detail about that in a bit. Now, the interesting thing about video, I'm going to go into view more video details and just show you a little bit of statistics behind this, because this is important. So for this particular video, we want to have a look at our audience retention. So the most of our audience, nearly all of it, watch through for the full 17 seconds, and looks like people cut out towards the very end, until we include views under 15 seconds. So after 3 seconds, we start to lose our audience. By halfway through our video, we only have half of them. This is definitely more noticeable when you look at longer videos. Let's look at a longer video. We do a lot of video with this particular business, so let me pull up a longer one.
G'day, everybody.
The butchers again. We're just going to go into the video detail. And let's have a look at audience retention. So it looks good to begin with until we remove the 15-second views. And by 17 seconds, we have 36% of the audience and only 23% actually finished the video. So straight away, this is pretty indicative that when we create video, the first 5 to 6 seconds matter. You need to have something that's going to capture the attention of your audience and get them to actually watch it through. I know that this statistics is actually pretty good for this business, but the majority are going to have way less. When you start digging into your information, you'll probably find that by halfway through, you only have 5 or 10% of your audience. So it's important that you make sure that you design really engaging content that your customers are going to connect with straight away. I'm just going to actually play this video for you, so you get a bit of an idea on how we connect with them immediately.
Mick from Parkhurst Quality Meats, and this is Jimmy here.
And love is in the air, everywhere.
So around about 6 seconds, we've got the butcher here being absolutely silly and singing along.
Everywhere I look around, love is in the air.
These guys are naturally very engaging characters, and our customers do connect with them.
So Valentine's
Day. So the approach to your video is important. If you need to have something that's going to connect almost immediately. Otherwise, you're better off utilizing photographic content. With a photo, you sell your message instantly, and then they look at the caption, which further sells it. With a video, you have a multitude of seconds. So making sure you pick a good thumbnail is also important. And the other thing that I recommend
To do
is add your closed captions.
Everybody.
Not everyone is watching videos with audio on. Sometimes they're in a public environment, and they don't have their headphones, so add the closed captions. It's also useful for your hearing impaired disabled customers, which there is a few. In terms of video as well, the other type of video that you're probably going to see with social media is your story content. Your story content doesn't necessarily actually have to be video. It can be photographic content put together as video, but it's generally very short-term content. It's only up there for 24 hours. Main difference is it's also shot in a vertical portrait style. Tends to be a little bit simpler. It's a little bit more real, just what's happening in the business then and there. And can be a little bit more engaging. This feeds really nicely into the last example I want to show you. Trying to get my social to work properly, which is a slightly different platform. Facebook and Instagram are very much the same and very similar, but when we start looking at TikTok, the way we do video definitely changes. It has to be more engaging. Now, the reason why I mentioned TikTok, if we look at the statistics across all platforms, Facebook, the average Australian spends 16.1 hours a month on. Instagram is 8.2 hours a month. And TikTok is 16.8 hours a month. So it's definitely a growing platform. The second thing to note about that particular platform is that it was the second most downloaded app in Australia last year. The number one most downloaded app was Zoom. Next thing to note is that the demographics of the people that are on the platform is heading northward. They're getting older. At one point there was your under 18 market. Now it's closer to being your under 25 market. So it's tapping into the Instagram market, which is traditionally 18 through to your 30, and your Facebook is your 30 plus. So you really have to understand where your audience is, but TikTok is a growing platform. Now I'm going to be using the example of Millennium Comics, which is another business that's given me permission to use their profile for the purposes of this video, this webinar. Now, Millennium Comics last year had 36,000 people visit their website. And for the 1.5 months that we have been doing TikTok marketing for them, they've had 146,000 people visit their website. So they've had a massive increase in attention, and that's also led to sales. I'm just going to show you a few little examples of the videos that we have put up for them. So this one went viral with 76.8 thousand views.
The Witcher. Netflix series based on.
So we're using the built-in voiceover functions that come with TikTok. So we don't do voiceover, and it's just over the shot, shoulder shot. Nothing flash, No audio, no lights, just straight from the camera. Let me show you another example, something that's a little bit flashier with editing. I know it's hit somewhere. This one. Come give me a tune. So you don't have to dance for likes on TikTok. But it is definitely audience driven and content driven. This particular video had 460 likes on it and 31 comments. Now, I'm harping on a lot about TikTok. It's probably something that's a little bit new to you, but it is such an important platform for video. And whatever you're shooting on here can go straight across to being used for your story format as well. And for most users, creating video stories is definitely the way to engage with your audience because they're looking for that short-term content. The big difference with TikTok, and this is the real benefit behind creating video for it, is that if you put something up on Facebook, only your direct audience that engages with you is going to see that content. If you put something up on TikTok, if you put it on Facebook, only your direct audience is going to engage. If you put it on TikTok, it shows it to a small group of people. If those small group of people engage with it, shows it to a larger group, say 100 people. If those 100 people engage with it, show it to 1,000, up to 10,000, 100,000, 1,000,000, 10 million. So it's one of the few platforms left that you can go viral on. And it's going to position your content first to the Australian market, and then it's going to expand outwards from there to larger and larger markets overseas. Now, you might only reach 1% of people in your local area, but if you add to your business by having more people seeing it, it's going to be beneficial. So I want to show you one last example video, and then we'll get on to talking about how to improve the quality of your video and how to actually do some filming. So Pogi's mechanical. He's a mechanic. He started off working for someone else, and he went from working for someone else to working for himself and having his own shop, just through content that he posted on TikTok. And this is a very good example video explaining his business.
It may be a little...
So here's the question is, how many regular customers can you provide services for? Just asking because if you're 100K followers or wanted a service, you'd be really busy. I'm just going to refresh the page that comes to the start.
I work on basically, I would estimate maybe, and I don't reckon it's even this high, would be 1% would be in my area, followers on TikTok. It may be a little bit higher, it might be lower. That's 1,450 people. If I get half of them as customers, I'm doing amazingly well and this makes this worthwhile. A lot of my customers tell me they come from seeing us on TikTok and yeah, it's working. Saying that, would I be able to service 100,000 followers? No shop in Australia can handle that. So no, I wouldn't be doing that. But most of the customers, most of the people following me aren't from this area locally, but a small percentage of them are. But that small percentage, even if it's only 1%, is more than I can handle. So yeah, that's how my marketing works. All right, so I work on basically...
So it has a huge reach, huge amount of potential. And the style of video is just literally a face to camera as he talks and explains how he does it. And a lot of his videos are that. A lot of it is behind the scenes, things he found as he's fixing cars. So it's not professional. He's not even using professional audio, but the story is what's important and the story is what people are connecting with. There's literally hundreds of examples here of businesses that have gone viral from showcasing themselves just on TikTok. So at this point in time, does anyone have any questions around that part? If you do, use the chat and question and answer functions in Zoom controls below. And if not, what we're going to do is go on to talking about some of those tools and techniques that you can use to improve the quality of your video. Okay, so it doesn't look like we have any questions at the moment. So one of the things that is really important after we've got a good story, and videos that have good story are things that explain, tell, and showcase. Depending on what business you're in, it's probably very front-facing to your customers and they don't get to see the behind the scenes in your business. So taking your customers out the back and showing them how things are actually done is something very interesting for them because they haven't seen that before. So do a little bit of a showcase and try and have people in it because all social media platforms connect with the element of being social. From story, we move on to audio. So when we start talking about audio, there's a few different styles. The audio that you have on your mobile phone is what's called omnidirectional microphone. It's designed to pick up audio from all around you. That's how you can stand here with your phone and be on speakerphone and your mates can be yelling behind you and the person can hear it, but it becomes a jumbled mess of noise. When we start looking at professional audio, we start to look at directional audio. And there's a few different styles. The old-fashioned TV reporter is probably the one that you're most common with. When you hold a mic, you point it at yourself and you get good quality audio. You point it away and you can't hear anything. This is a directional microphone, mostly used for interview style. The mic that comes with your headphones for your mobile phones, that's a directional microphone, where it needs to be close to the audio source for the user to be able to hear it. The microphone that I'm using today for this webinar is a directional microphone, in that if I spin at 180, you're not gonna be able to hear me as well as you are right now. In fact, if I switch it from my desktop microphone up to my webcam, imagine the quality of the audio and what you can hear has just got a lot worse than it was with my directional microphone. So I'll switch that back for you. So directional microphones work by minimizing outside noise and just take on the noise from the direction. The next type of directional microphone is the shotgun mic. As the name describes, it works like a shotgun, where the noise closest to it collects first and then expands outwards. But it's directional as well because you point in a direction, you'll capture audio from that. And good quality ones will not capture any noise from behind the microphone. You only capture noise forward. You tend to find this style microphone most often on studio or movie sets, normally on a boom where it's pointed down towards the actors or actresses. My favorite type of microphone though, and you can get all these type of microphones in mini version for your mobile phone, but my favorite type of microphone has to be the Rode Wireless Goes. And I'll show you what they look like. This is your Rode Wireless Go. That first video I showed you with the butcher, I pointed out a little black thing that was clipped onto a shirt. That was one of these mics. These mics are very, very powerful directional microphone in that they connect with just the audio that's immediately near them. They'll give you a very, very good audio quality. You can always forgive bad video quality, but you cannot forgive bad audio quality. So they have a few different connections to charge them up. They have these things here. Now, these are called dead cats or windsocks. In the industry, we call them dead cats. And they're designed to go over the top of a microphone and block out any wind noise. You probably get those wind whistling noises that cut out your audio when you're filming, especially outdoors. The little fluffy socks on your microphones will prevent that wind noise. So you can be standing outside in a gale and get clean and clear audio. So these mics can plug directly into your mobile phone. You can get lavs as well, which are these little mics that then plug into them. And they'll just massively improve the quality of your audio. These are a little bit expensive though, in that they generally start around about $400. If you're just looking for a little short, easy microphone setups, just jump on and literally type in mics for mobiles, and you'll get a few different options at a few different price points from a few different products. But I generally recommend that everyone works on the idea of improving their audio. The next thing is improving your actual video visual. There's two ways to do this. The first one is movement, and the second one is lighting. And you can generally hit two birds with one stone here. For anyone who's ever done anything with the fashion industry, you're probably very familiar with the ring light and stand. When we talk about movement, we talk about either stable movement. So right now, my webcam is stable movement. Or we talk about dynamic movement. In dynamic movement, either the subject is moving or the camera is moving. If you're doing dynamic movement, generally you're looking at using some sort of gimbal that will stabilize your video footage so that it looks smooth. Or you're looking for character movement where you're moving around. The nice thing with the mobile phone technology is that it's starting to have a lot more inbuilt stabilization. If you're not having any movement and you're not familiar with gimbals, then I definitely recommend you go with the ring light. The ring light is incredibly effective and it's quite cheap in that you can get them for less than $100. It has two benefits. The first one being is that it has a spot for your phone to go to help stabilize your footage. The second one is it has the lighting to improve the quality of your footage. With lighting, it can become a very, very complicated subject in that there's different colors of light. But generally, as long as you can see the picture, that is all that matters. I keep coming back to the quality recommendation for the size of the ring light. That's actually a good question. If you have a ring light, you want it to be bigger than the subject that you're filming. So if you're filming yourself, you want it to be bigger than your head. If you're filming product, you want it to be bigger than the product. If you're generally bigger light is better because it will fill more medium. So right now I'm sitting in my office and as you can notice, there's casting and shadowing on my face. So it doesn't make for very good footage. If I move back a little bit and angle my head in, now you're seeing that I'm getting white spots across my forehead. That's what we call blowout. So it's too bright. So I'd want to reduce the amount of light that I'm delivering. So what you're looking for when you talk lighting is you're looking for even tone across your subject. So if you're filming a product, you want to make sure that all the colors still look the same or as close to natural as you can get it. When you get shadowing like this, which is what we call casting, then generally the recommendation is to add additional lighting. So that's just the light on my mobile phone. But as you notice, that's too bright and that I'm getting blown out. So you want to find a nice balance in terms of your lighting. So somewhere about there, I'm getting less shadowing. One important thing with any lighting or when you're filming, if you're trying to get something semi-set up, is if my light is from above, suddenly I look a lot more tired than I actually am. If I bring my light from the bottom, again, I'm getting casting. So you're looking for positioning of your light where your subject looks the best. As you can see, it's taken out a lot of that dark shade from underneath my eyes. Naturally, wherever you have any shadow and casting around eyes, it makes your subject look a lot worse than they actually are. Although I might be tired because it is Friday and I have a lot of events on this week. So lots of early morning, lots of late nights. So making sure your lighting is important, making sure your footage is stable as possible, whether it's through a stand or stable movement, and making sure that you have good quality audio. But again, audio always wins. I want to show you a very good example of this as well. We're turning to YouTube here with one of the most famous YouTubers in the world, a guy called Casey Neistat. Now, Casey went viral before the era of YouTube. So we're going back before 2007 here. And he produced a series of videos shot on really old point and shoot cameras and a few different styles of them. But the one that he's most known for is having a go at Apple for their non-replaceable battery. I'm just having a look for that one. I'm actually beginning to think he might have taken it down because he does work for Apple now. but it was the video that made him famous and it looks like he's taken it down. Probably to protect his brand, but I will show you a different example one that he shot for Nike. And it was shot all on a point and shoot camera. One moment. It's called Make It Count. Okay, a little video example, and let's get it live.
Definitely make this flight, but we're cutting it close. So far the trip is off to a fairly irresponsible start. And so it begins. I'm trying to learn to keep my mind in check. We got to Paris, 17 degrees outside. The airport is in effect.
Welcome to Cairo. So it's got a nice little audio track to it, but I want to point out a few things. So he uses a combination of movement shots, and the filming here is actually shot on a camera that's way worse than any mobile phone that any of you could possibly own. We have a series of shots like this one, which is stable in that the camera is in a fixed position, but he enters the frame through running. And a combination of handheld footage where he's just literally moving the camera around to create movement through the film.
All in all, very successful. We visited Tahrir Square. We rode horses. But Max almost fell off of his.
That bit there we call editing to the beat, in that each time there's a beat, the footage changes. It's getting a little bit more complicated video.
Now commence our descent.
We're in Johannesburg, South Africa right now. Just got to Zambia.
But where he doesn't have movement with the camera, he creates movement with his subject. So moving in and out. You can finish watching the rest of this video yourself if you want to and have a look at those other ones, but potentially the quality of the camera here does not play into the quality of the video. The storyline's there, he has natural movements, he's not shooting with any advanced lighting, he's not even shooting with any advanced audio equipment. It's literally a point and shoot camera. By point and shoot, I'll show you what I mean by that. It's literally a pocket-sized handheld camera. Share screen. This is what I'm talking about. This is a pretty common camera style before mobile phones got too popular. I probably have half a dozen of these cameras. I don't use them anymore because my mobile phone takes way better quality stuff than these cameras ever could. And that's just a reality of the way that the industry is going. Okay, so at this point in time, I am going to be setting up for the second part, which is where I'm actually going to be connecting my phone to this stream and showing you how to actually do some filming on your mobile phone. This will take me a minute or two to set up, so I'm just going to pause the recording. If you have any questions, please do ask them at this point in time, and I'll be back in a moment. Again, we're back. So we're on my mobile phone and I'm just going to open up my camera app. So we're met straight away by my messy desk and my Boba Fett. So he's going to be our subject for the purposes of how to do the filming. So I'm in photo mode, so I'm going to switch over to video mode. First thing is it's jumped forward to, because I got three cameras as part of my mobile phone. So I want to go to the ultra wide. The wider you sit, the more warped your footage is going to be. As you zoom in, it's going to be more even and more straight. But as you go longer, you're going to get a lot more movement down the line. It's going to look more noticeable. So you want to find a balance where your footage looks good and it looks stable. So there's two parts to filming. The first one is I like to use the grid lines. So if you don't have your grid lines, go into your settings and you'll find a grid lines function. The grid lines are those grids that come up on the screen and just help you with making sure your shot's even. So you line them up so they're even to your subject. The next thing is you have to decide what you're filming for. If you're filming for TikTok or story, then portrait is definitely the way to go. If you're filming for Facebook or YouTube, you're going to be switching it over and you're going to be filming in landscape. Now, I do know that that hasn't been reflected in the webinar stream, but filming this way, rotate that screen and you want to be shooting in landscape. So making sure you choose your medium is one of those first steps. Next step is to look at your subject. Shooting straight on can sometimes be a bit boring. Moving to one side or the other can create a more dynamic imagery with your subject. The other thing to note is your subject. Subjects tend to have direction. Having him point one way and leaving some negative space in this side can make the video more appealing than just shooting a straight on imagery. Looking at this from my mug, if I'm shooting straight on, I look very flat. If I tilt my head slightly and move the camera away, it looks a lot more interesting than me filming straight on. Going back to Dover, the next thing we want to have a look at is what settings we're going to be using. So we'll go into settings again, and as you note, there is a few different settings. So I'm using the rear camera here, and I'm shooting in full HD at 30 frames per second. So your frame rate is how fast your footage is and gives you the options to be able to slow down. Also have a few different scales here as well. So if I go 1:1, I'm now shooting in a square format. So you want to make sure that you have the right setting for the video that you're filming. In this case, 16:9 is the format for stories and for TikTok. Depending on what settings you have here as well, you also have options for different frame rates. If I go down to a more smaller, that's front facing. If I go to a smaller resolution, so maybe full. Okay, I don't have the option on this one, but some cameras have the option for 120 frames per second, which can allow you to capture some really, really cool slow motion footage. I'm just going to keep it on full HD. Now, take note that when you're filming anything, like posting anything on Instagram, TikTok, or Facebook, it's going to reduce the size, the quality down to 1280 by 720, which is that bottom one. But you generally want to upload in slightly higher quality format just so that your picture looks nicer. It's not going to use any of those 4K options that I have up the top there, which is the UHD, ultra high definition. So making sure you pick the right frame rate is important. At the top of my screen here, and depending on if you're on Apple or Android, you're going to have different options here, but all be the same. You have the option to change your ratio, again, between 9:16, 1:1, full, etc. This one here allows for super steady footage in that it's actually going to have an inbuilt stabilizer. So if I'm looking for really stable footage, I can turn on that stabilizer. We have the option as well for flash, but in this particular case, it's blowing out my subject. Now I'm getting that clear off the top of them. So I'm going to turn that off. Next step is quite literally just to do the filming. And I can't actually film on here while I'm on the Zoom call just because it won't allow me. But what I'd generally be doing is doing a tracking in shot where I'd be trying to move around him and show some dynamic movement because the Boba Fett is stable. Just with that as well, you'll notice that it's going completely out of blur, out of focus. if I use that yellow circle that's popped up, if I press and hold that, what it's going to do is it's going to activate a focus lock. So the focus isn't going to change from that point. If I tap it once, it's going to autofocus onto them, and then I can lock that focal point and I'll maintain the focus. And you'll notice below the screen here, I have this plus and minus that's popped up. This has to do with your exposure. So you can take something and increase and decrease the exposure by plus and minusing it. So that can just improve the quality of your picture if you're shooting in a darker environment. Is there any questions around that part? Okay, at this point in time, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you the option to have a direct conversation if you do have any direct questions. So I'm just going to give you all the option to join as a panelist. So you can have a direct conversation if you have any questions. What I'll be doing at this point is, if you just want to get set up for that, I will just tell you a little bit about Business Station. So Business Station run these courses as part of the Digital Solutions program. And through the Digital Solutions program, you can access one-on-one advice and support for only $44. So you have access, the ability to get support with all these different subjects. For $44, you'll get 3 hours of personalized support and 4 hours of group workshop. To register, you must have fewer than 20 employees, be in Western Australia, Queensland, Northern Territory, and be operating to make a profit unless you're in Queensland, in which case you have the opportunity to join our not-for-profit program. You can access the program through Business Station and Digital Solutions. I've been Liam Fahey for Business Station. And this has been Better Smartphone Video Creation.